Well, I came down here on the train, and none of us would be any surprise to you that when you get off that train, which I did with about 60 other people, there's no sign saying where the bus is, but I followed the crowd, and we waited for about 7 minutes for a bus to turn up, which was mostly full, and we crushed on, and a lot of people had to wait for the next bus. And a missions training team is not going to fix that, unfortunately. No matter how well designed or how good it is. And it's measures like that across the economy and society that really need to be fixed up and improved. There was right there, like 60 people for 7 minutes, so that's 7 hours of human productive capacity just standing there and getting wasted. And that's a pretty major inefficiency in our society. All because some noddy can't fix up the timetables. So that the bus arrives just before the train arrives, and then lets people get off and get on the train, and is waiting there for me when I get off the train to immediately connect, come straight back here. The last thing the Greens really want to spend their recent years talking about is an emissions trading scheme and what's right about it and what's wrong about it. Because even if it's well designed, it would not be very much the heavy lifting that we need to do in order to reduce our emissions. Pools of carbon stored. Very large pool known as fossil fuels. Used to be a lot more CO2 in the atmosphere over millions of years, literally being sucked out by plants. Buried in the ground through various processes, squashed down, turned into coal, turned into oil. So far we've pulled a small bit of it out and emitted it into the atmosphere. I think we can safely say that the amount of new coal getting created through various processes is so small that we don't need to actually put it on the diagram. Look at this other pool over here. It's all about natural ecosystems. Ocean's much bigger actually, but it's a bit complicated, so I'll let that out of it. But if you just think about surface ecosystems, traditionally a much bigger sink than source, and in fact the net pull up of CO2 out of the atmosphere, but the way we're creating it now, the way we're treating it now is actually reversing itself, and there's more coming out of that pool than is being absorbed back in. Big Finance Stern report was that the net of this is perhaps about 30% of our emissions, or stuff the other 70%. And that means it's quite significant as pool. In fact, you can't do this job simply by addressing fossil issues if you're trying to get deep and rapid cuts heading towards zero by somewhere mid-century. Think about every single possible technology, and by one estimate, you could reduce the trajectory of our fossil fuel emissions by about 3% a year. So if you did that and that alone, you won't get as fast as we would if you address the issue of ecosystems. And then over here, as a bit of a mystery, we've got our farmlands. I have to say that we don't measure these stocks in any way. We don't measure these pools. We tend to measure flow. If you pull down Australia's greenhouse inventory, you'll see a measurement of flow of CO2, either moving out or moving back in to the pool. And when we look at farmlands, all we really see in that inventory is the emissions from cows and the absorption by forestry plantations, particularly as they've been moving along lately, mainly bluegums and so forth. And we know nothing about soil carbon or any of the other issues that are going on in an agricultural system. So, a few things about the emissions trading system as it was designed. Targets too low. Targets 4%. You might have heard 5%, but that's 5% from 2000 levels. Almost all targets you ever hear about comparatively are countries are based on 1990 levels. And if you use 1990 as the baseline, then their target is effectively 4% reduction goal. That's number one. But if it was only that the goal was to work, you might be able to make an argument to let's get the architecture of emissions trading scheme in place. A lot bigger problems with it than just that. Secondly, massive compensation to police. And that is a particular problem. If you go back to prior to the federal election, you'll remember that Kevin Rudd said, I'm going to sign Kyoto. And most people said, great, that means he's going to reduce emissions. He also said that Ross Garner was going to tell him what his policy should. Again, Ross Garner on behalf of the Labor Party, most of the Labor state governments running around. And for whatever reason, we more or less accepted that as an approach. That was, we were prepared to vote for Kevin Rudd on the basis that Guru Garner was going to produce this magical policy. And Garner said, whatever you do, don't give compensation to polluters, don't give free credit. And there's a particular reason that he said that. An emissions trading scheme is basically a way of people with low-cost ways of reducing their emissions to swap with people who have higher-cost ways of reducing their emissions. And they do all that within a cap, obviously, that's their fixed amount, unfortunately. Now, most of the big polluters have ways to reduce their emissions. The big coal mines, the big coal burning power stations, could, for example, rebuild their boilers as much as more emissions. And they would produce a very large quantity of emissions savings just like that. The most likely outcome